Heart with an open spirit and mind, and just let God soften it up for us today, all right? There's something that God's been reminding me of constantly throughout the daily word that I just read, and it's from Ezekiel 11. It's also mentioned in Ezekiel 36, but let me read it for you. It says, "And I will give them one heart, and a new spirit I will put within them. I will remove the heart of stone from their flesh, and I will give them a heart of flesh, that they may walk in my statutes, and give them my rules and obey them. And they shall be my people, and I will be their God." So church, he will change us. Just let us come today. Just let the Spirit fill us. Just let God fill us today. and using what God gives us, let us just pour out to Him. Let us pour out to each and every person alongside us and recognize that this life of ours is not ours. That this heart of ours is not ours. And the voices that we use to sing praises to God, it's not ours, it's God's. And once we know that, just let us give it all to Him. Let us sing loudly for Him. Let us listen clearly for Him. And just let Him change us today. And let's just sing of how good the Father is. And let's just sing and speak of His goodness and of His grace that He has for us today. So let's take pride in the Father. Let's take pride in Jesus. And let's sing this song together.
I could run 1,000 miles to win the race of life.
Without you, Lord, who am I?
Thank you.
Hillsong, all have a seat. Welcome to Journey Church of Atlanta. Welcome to our joint service. I'm so glad you are all here. Tech, Emery, and Oxford, hope you guys are enjoying your fall break right now. Hope it is fun or restful. Everyone else, hi, I hope you're doing well as well and you're enjoying your week. My name is Justin. I'll be giving the announcements for today. If you are here for the first time or consider yourself new, welcome. We are glad you're here. We would love to get to know you. We will have a welcoming table set up in the foyer in the back, ready to answer any questions you may have, tell you a little bit more about our church, and let you know how you can get more involved. I also encourage you, if you're new, to stay in a sanctuary or a fellowship and to meet some new people. I encourage everyone to meet someone new. Which brings us to our first announcement, Eat and Meet. It is going to be our monthly Eat and Meet next week on October 15th at 12:15 p.m. Please come enjoy free food provided by our amazing hospitality team, and it will be in the fellowship hall. As a reminder, we do have, or Outlet has their service in a sanctuary during that time. So if you're coming to Eat and Meet in the fellowship hall, please enter through the side doors to not disturb the service here. And this might be a big ask, but as you're leaving as well, please also exit through the side doors and come around and enter through the main door so our amazing welcoming team can welcome you properly and usher you into the space. I do believe next week is joint, or is not joint service. So this is only be before Eastside service. So I'm sorry, college students, this will only be before Eastside service. But the next announcement is for you, our college retreat. It is October 27th to 29th. We'll be leaving Friday, coming back Sunday. I highly, highly, highly encourage any college students who are still on the fence to sign up. It's a great time to be spiritually nourished and for good fellowship. And plus, this year's theme is great. It's zeal, fighting against apathy and religiosity, and pursuing a real, genuine faith. I also want to remind you, if you have not signed up, please sign up now, because next week, Sunday, October 15th, is the last day for regular signups. After that, it will be late registration. So right now, registration is $95. After next Sunday, October 15th, it will be $105. That's an increase of $10. Please just sign up, like, save your money. We don't want that extra $10. It's just there so you sign up on time. Keep it, sign up early. I do know that for a lot of college students, finance might be an issue. It might be a concern for signing up. If you have issues with finance, please contact us. Contact the events team at events@journeychurchatl.com. We don't want finance to be a reason why you don't come. And for Eastside, thank you for all those who have signed up to become small group leaders for our college retreat. We are still looking for a few more small group leaders. So if you're thinking about it, praying about it, please sign up. Our college students, they're really great. Ministering to them is a huge blessing. They are very curious, and college is such a form of time in their faith. So I encourage you guys to sign up. Please talk to P. Minsu if you are interested. Right now, he's currently out of town, so he's not in service today, but when he comes back, let him know. That weekend, if you're not able to make it to retreat, on that Saturday, October 28th, we have another event called Trunk and Treat. So Trunk and Treat is an event we do with City Hope. We do it at their two locations, Indian Valley and Clarkson. And basically what it is a time where you get together with a family group, you decorate a trunk of a car, and you wear like matching costumes, and you set up like a station or like mini games for the kids in the Clarkson community. They come and they play the games, and they win, they get candy. It's a great way for City Hope to connect with the families there who are not already, who don't already know about City Hope, and build relationships with them. But it's also a great bonding time for you and your family group to decorate together, wear matching, like coordinating matching costumes. Usually there's a theme, it's a lot of fun. So if you're interested, contact your family group host or contact Leah Carroll. If you have any questions, you can email her at leah6151@gmail.com or Slack her. These two events are gonna be the last weekend of October, like I mentioned, which will be like end of spooky season. And then we'll be going into November, which is the beginning of the kind of Thanksgiving season. So our next announcement is our families and teachers Friendsgiving, hosted at Pastor Dan and Tammy's house. This is for our families and Journey teachers. Please RSVP and sign up for a side dish, dessert, or drink to bring. Tammy, who's helping host this Friendsgiving, also has an organization called Connected mind. This organization seeks to support and empower adoptive foster families, as well as caregivers and organizations that serve children who have experienced trauma. One of their many services is a kids club. It's an after-school kids club where volunteers come and help students with their homework and then engage with them in fun, creative activities to build social skills, empower them and their families. We are looking for volunteers for this after-school kids club. It's on Wednesdays from 3:15 to 5 p.m. We're also looking for volunteers to help prep for the kids club as well, and that's going to be a monthly commitment, about a couple hours a month, depending on the role. So if you're interested, there's a sign-up form on our link tree. If you want more information, you can read it on their website, which is also on the link tree. If you have any questions, you contact Tammy Johnson at tammy@theconnectedvinefamilies.com. And this is our QR code. I'll give you a second to scan it as I talk. As a reminder, this will give you or take you to our link tree, which has all announcements I just previously mentioned. So whether it's Eat and Meet, College Retreat, Trunk and Treat, the Friendsgiving, and Connected Vine, you can access it through here, as well as there's some other stuff too. There's like journey bowl pictures and everything. So sign up or scan that if you want more information. All right, now I'll be going into a time of Missions Minute. Typically, Missions Minute, we lift up a missions partner, but today is something different. If you guys don't know, we, Journey Church, are part of a church community called AMI, or Acts Ministry International. And this community, they've asked us to pray for them. Recently, there has been a lot of complications with health among some pastors and families within our church community, and they would really just love support and prayer from the churches. And so starting off was Pastor Eddie. He is the head pastor at Canvas City Church in Philadelphia. He's been fighting through cancer. He's been receiving treatment. Last week, he was hospitalized due to a rare infection, and he was discharged, but a couple days ago, he went back to the ER because of fever. So just pray over healing for Pastor Eddie. Next is Pastor John Moon. He's a pastor and missionary in Coban, Guatemala. His father, this past weekend, had a heart attack, but luckily he was able to be operated on. He received two stents, and he's recovering, so just pray for a smooth recovery. And finally, Pastor Keith, the head pastor of Church of Southland in Anaheim. His mother's not doing too well. She was, yesterday, was sent to the ER, and right now she is a little bit disoriented and not very coherent, so just pray over her and her situation. But yeah, we are one universal church, so we want to be praying for our leaders in our community as well. We'll be praying after a short time of offering, where we honor God through our finances. You can access our offering page through our church website, journeychurchatl.com/give. I'll give you a minute to do so, and also to pray over the missions minute and the offering, and then I'll close this. Dear Father, Lord, you are our God. You are God of this church, God of our church network. You're God of our families. You're God of this nation. God, you are God over health and sickness, over life and death, Lord. And God, we know it is your power to heal. We know it is your power. It is your control, Lord. And we place our trust in you, our faith in you, Lord. We pray for Pastor Eddie. We pray for healing over him. We pray and he's wrestling with cancer and going in and out of the hospital, Lord. I pray that you may engage with him, Lord, that as he's going through suffering and pain, Lord, that he would draw closer to you, God, and you would be with him every single moment. Lord, I pray for Pastor John Moon's father. I pray that he would have a smooth recovery, Lord. Thank you for the medical professionals who operated on him. Thank you for allowing him to receive a successful medical procedure, Lord. I pray just for a quick recovery. I pray for Pastor John as well. I pray that he would trust in you, that you are taking care of his father while he's on missions. I pray that you may know that you love his father and you are there to take care of him. And Lord, lastly, I pray for Pastor Keith. I pray for his mother. I pray that you would allow her to be healed and recover, Lord. I pray for the medical professionals who are working with her. I pray for her family. I pray for patience and love, that they may be able to be with her and support her, God. And I pray for AMI Church as in general, just be lifting up our pastors and really praying for them and caring for them. I pray for all the other events going on in Journey Church, Lord. I pray for all the hearts for people who are signing up and people who are helping the background and setting these things up, and for people attending as well, Lord. I pray that you may be pleased and pray that you may be glorified in all we do, whether eating or drinking, we do in your glory. And lastly, Lord, I pray for Pastor Dan and for a sermon today. Lord, I pray that what he speaks and what he says to you today will be pleasing to you, Lord, and that you would speak to us on the stage, Lord, and we receive graciously and receive your word. Just name pray.
Thank you. I feel like I told this story before in this church, perhaps, but when I was a kid, my dad had us memorize a chapter of scripture, and we were at my grandma's house. We often took our camper up there and would stay for a month in her yard in Duluth, Minnesota, the real Duluth, and we memorized a whole chapter and then quoted it for my grandma. And my grandma was so delighted that she gave us a prize. And that prize was a dime. And though I am older than you, I am not so old that a dime was ever a lot of money in my lifetime. And I tell that story now because we have gotten to that chapter. That chapter that we quoted for grandma was John 15. And it's a bit of an auspicious chapter to arrive to, because ever since the retreat in January, the Eastside retreat, and other sermons that have been preached around that time and at times throughout this year, abide has been a theme. And this is the chapter about abiding. I'll be preaching from the NIV today, and the word there is used remain. Same thing. Remain in me, abide in me, this idea of what it means to be in Christ. So my sermon today is a picture of what do we see from these first 12 verses of John 15 that kind of show us what it means to have this life in Christ, which most of us that are here would probably put ourselves in that category. We're here because we are in Christ. We have decided that this is the faith, the God that we profess and that we follow. And what is it? What does it look like? I doubt all of us collectively or any of us individually are getting it, like, you know, exactly right, perfectly, bullseyed, right down the middle. But we're wanting that, right? We're wanting to, as we mature and grow, ever get our lives aligned with what it is that this life is about. And so I think when I came to the first 12 verses of John 15 today, what I saw was sort of this picture of what does this life entail? What does it have for me? What am I doing to be living in it? And I came up with four things. And so there'll be four pieces of this picture that will be presented today. But then when I finished and I got through to verse 12, I felt like I still had some questions, And I felt like, I know there's going to be someone sitting in the audience that's going to have these questions too. And so I've kind of got a tacked on ending of some of the leftovers, like things that I didn't really cover in the 4 points, and they're just going to be like 4 questions at the end, and that's how we'll wrap up. So because it's more points than usual, it's not like just ABC, 1, 2, 3, I've contributed a PowerPoint, so you won't have to keep 8 things in your mind only. They'll be up there to help you kind of follow along as we go. I haven't filled in the answers or anything, but it will give you where we're going. So the first one is, actually, before we do that, let's together, let me pray one more time, and then we're going to just get into pairs or trios and read the 12 verses together so that we have the text in our minds. Lord, would you be in this place and make your presence known to us in this place? And as we gather together to wrestle with your word and to engage the thoughts that Jesus spoke to his disciples so many years ago, Father, I pray that we would be sparked in our imaginations to more deeply desire abiding in you, remaining in you, and all that that means. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. So would you take just a minute, and it's not up on the screen, just with the person next to you. If you want to do NIV, which I'll be preaching in, that's great. If you want to read ESV or some other version that you have, that's fine. But just read it in groups of 2 or 3, and it's 12 verses. Won't take you long. Go. Okay, thank you for the music, and I hope I'm not cutting off too many of you. I think most of you are done, and I'm glad now that that passage is fresh in your mind. And let me just say something about my 4 points. I am not contending that Jesus is making these 4 points, like he's speaking in that kind of a manner. He's not speaking like that. He's speaking across a very great breadth of things, but these four points that I'm making are more just things to observe and take note of as we engage this passage. And so the first one is, take note of the origin of our life in Christ. The origin of a life in Christ. If I asked you just out of the blue, you know, what are you going to do to abide in Jesus? You're going to probably start with something personal, like I am going to do this. And I want us to take our minds out of using ourselves as a beginning point and putting ourselves in the place of belonging to a much larger, more ancient, predating human beings even, story. Verse 1 says, I am the true vine and my Father is the gardener. Verse 9 says, as the Father has loved me, so I have loved you. John 1:1, how this book began. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. I saw somebody once translate that verse as, in the beginning was the relationship. This idea of abiding didn't begin when you decided to follow Christ, and then therefore now you have to learn how to plug yourself in to Jesus. It started much, much longer ago. And even if we're going to deal with it on the human being level, we should start here where Jesus is saying these words to, not me, but to the disciples. Maybe for me eventually, but it was said to the disciples. And it was originally not for me, it was for John's original audience. And when we look at that context and see how far back up the line it is from us, I think what's going to be in their minds is an Old Testament passage. They steeped themselves in their Holy Scriptures, in the Hebrew Scriptures, and I believe that Isaiah 5 is going to be a passage. I think it's going to be on the screen, but I'm just going to read it for you. I think this passage is going to be front and center in the disciples' minds, because what it means to talk about God's vineyard and God's vines was nothing new to them. It was a familiar concept. Listen to Isaiah, and this is the chapter right before his famous vision of who will go send me. In the year before King Uzziah, I saw a vision of the Lord filling the temple and the smoke and the coal touching his lips. You know that chapter? This is the chapter right before that. I will sing for the one I love a song about his vineyard. My loved one had a vineyard on a fertile hillside. He dug it up and cleared it of stones and planted it with the choicest vines. He built a watchtower in it and cut out a wine press as well. Then he looked for a crop of good grapes, but it yielded only bad fruit. Now, you dwellers in Jerusalem and people of Judah, judge between me and my vineyard. What more could have been done for my vineyard than I have done for it? When I looked for good grapes, why did it yield only bad? Now I will tell you what I am going to do to my vineyard. I will take away its hedge, and it will be destroyed. I will break down its wall, and it will be trampled. I will make it a wasteland, neither pruned, nor cultivated, and briars and thorns will grow there. I will command the clouds not to rain on it. Verse 7. Would you read verse 7 aloud with me? Ready? Begin. The vineyard of the Lord Almighty is the nation of Israel, and the people of Judah are the vines he delighted in. And he looked for justice, but saw bloodshed, for righteousness, but heard cries of distress. Last verse I'll read. Woe to you who add house to house and join field to field, till no space is left and you live alone in the land. And so the Lord is looking for things in his land, in his vineyard, justice, righteousness, and he's not finding them. He's finding instead bloodshed, strife, oppression, people crying out in distress, people getting rich and pushing out or neglecting or oppressing the poor. I'm not going to say these verses are about America, even though you could describe some of those same kinds of things going in here, going on in this passage, but it does still show us what does God care about? What is God concerned about? And to be Jewish meant to grow up knowing that your nation was the Lord's vineyard and you were his precious vines. And Isaiah, long before the time of Jesus and the disciples, was prophesying the exile. And other nations were going to come in, Assyria to the northern kingdom, Babylon to the southern kingdom, and the vineyard was going to be shut down. And it's in this context now, 400 years after the end of the Old Testament, that Jesus comes on the scene and he says, I am the true vine. I am the true Israelite, the ultimate Israelite. Jesus is the true human, the ultimate human being. When people failed to fulfill their roles as the people of God, the priestly nation through whom all nations would come to see God, that's Exodus 19:6. Jesus is now coming, and the great question at the end of the Old Testament is, who are God's people on earth going to be now? And Jesus is coming to say, it all goes through me now. I am the way, the truth, and the life. I am the true vine. You are still branches, but now to be Israelite, to be Jewish, is not the way of cooperating with the Most High. It is now coming through Jesus alone, and he is the true vine. And the origin of this abiding, this remaining, predates Israel and predates Adam and Eve. It was what the Godhead already had before creation. And so I come to my second point now in our picture of this life in Christ. And it's purpose. What's the purpose of a life in Christ? Do you long for purpose? I think people can get the best, greatest job in the occupation or the major that they ever chose and sometimes be surprised by still longing for purpose. We are just made to know that what we do has meaning and purpose. And so why abide? Why this life? Why Christianity? Why follow Jesus? What is our purpose? Verse 2, 4, 5, and 8 all allude to what abiding is meant to do, what we are meant to produce. It says we will bear fruit. Now, this can be rather triggering as good capitalists that we are, living in a society where our value is constantly equated with what we can produce for our employer. And sometimes in church, we might feel this pressure to also produce, to do something, to serve in a way that we might be tempted to equate our worth with how much we produce. But I would like to remind you of bearing fruit in a New Testament sense is far, far different than producing something in a capitalistic economy. The most famous passage about bearing fruit, about having fruit, is in Ephesians or in Galatians 5. And it's the fruit of the Spirit. I am sure that as a group, we could name all 9 of those. What's the first one? I sort of heard you, but I to have my kids tell me I need hearing aids. So in that light, what's the first one? Oh, I heard that so much better. Second, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such there is no law. This is the fruit of the Spirit, and this is the kind of fruit that we bear in our lives, even though in Christian settings we sometimes forget this. We think about being really fruitful, bearing fruit for God, and maybe the first thing I'm thinking of isn't, am I joyful? I might be thinking more of, what am I producing that is visible and worthwhile? There's a purpose for us. It's bearing fruit. And like in the first point, though, it doesn't start and end with me. It isn't just about me. Me having kindness and goodness and self-control isn't just so that I can have kindness and goodness and self-control. Verse 8 tells us what else it is for. This is to my Father's glory, that you bear much fruit, showing yourselves to be my disciples. Now, glory is not a word we use a whole lot in regular everyday speech. We use it in church. We'll hear it in our worship singing. But I want you to take that word glory and take it out of a setting of just kind of like overt glorifying or praising or something like that, and think of it in terms of other people seeing something and having this reaction like, oh, that is great. That guy or that God is great. He made these things called human beings, and they are operating as created, as they're supposed to. I see, that's the kind of God he is. That kind of glory. In other words, when you live as a true human being, plugged into the true human being, the true Israelite, Jesus, and you have a life that is actually characterized by peace and patience and faithfulness, God is glorified because he created you to have that life, and other people can see that and say, glory to God. That is a real human being who is living out their purpose. This is so much different and so much less pressure than maintaining our witness. I'm not sure if you grew up in church where that was held up as sort of the standard or the purpose or the reason for you acting Christian, so that your witness was not tarnished, so that your witness didn't cause other people to stumble. No, this is my purpose, is to have to bear fruit for God's glory. And other people see how amazing that this God made people and amazing, these amazing creatures who live into this purpose and are experiencing it. The third, peace, in the picture of this life in Christ, is a goal. The goal of a life in Christ is stated in verse 11. And for the third time, it doesn't start with you. This is Jesus' goal. And he simply says, I have told you this. Why? So that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. Now, joy is one of the fruits of the Spirit, but here Jesus specifically says, the reason I'm telling you these things has to do with your happiness. And I'm collapsing joy and happiness into synonymous words here, which is the opposite, perhaps, of what I have sometimes heard done in Christian settings, where we talk about them as if they're very different things. I'm not sure the New Testament is coming up with that idea. In fact, the phrase I often heard was, God doesn't want you happy, he wants you holy. Very familiar phrase to me. If it is to you, or if it isn't to you, what kind of thinking, what kind of presuppositional thinking goes behind a statement like that? God doesn't want you happy, he wants you holy. You're presupposing that those two things lead to two different places, or that two different kinds of lives will each lead to one of those results. I think that's the wrong presupposition. I think Jesus here is saying, I want you happy. That maybe sounds a little, I don't know, childish or flimsy. But I think this idea that happiness results from doing things that you like, but God really wants you doing something else, something better, something higher, something harder, leads to a sense of pride in when we do those things, rather than recognizing a life lived towards holiness is simply following commands that God gave because he knew that is the only way in which human happiness truly occurs. Like, holiness isn't this alternative religious thing, and happiness is doing what you want and following all your desires. That's a temporal view of both of those things. And what God and his sovereign wisdom and his giving of the Torah, which is a blessing, and all his commands is doing is just simply saying, no, walking down that road isn't the road to happiness. It's just temporary gratification, but I know where it goes. And the road of delighting in the Lord's commands truly, seriously, really is the road to, you can call it joy, or you can call it happiness. I think the third picture here is simply Jesus saying, this also is the way towards being what you were designed to be in following the ultimate human being. We plug in and we abide and we learn. God is for us. He truly is. And last of the 4 points, not the last thing in the sermon, the last of the 4 points. I struggled with what word to use for this. It's taken from verses 9 through 12, and if you glance at that quickly, you could probably see what word is used more often than any other in there. But I used the word currency, the currency of our life in Christ. Like, what are we trading in? What are we bartering with? What are we exchanging with one another as we live this life in Christ together? And it's simply love. Verse 9 defines love as what the divine relationship is, as the Father has loved me. Verse 10 equates love with obeying Christ. If you keep my commands, you will remain in my love. Both verse 9 and 10 show us that the whole reason for the incarnation, the reason that the Son came to earth as a human being to die on the cross and rise again and be ascended, as the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. I have kept my Father's commands and remain in his love. The entire plan of Jesus coming and returning was all to bring us into that same love relationship that the Godhead already enjoyed, and Jesus cried out on the cross, it is finished. It was about far more than only paying a price for something you couldn't pay for. He was accomplishing and finishing a great work that both he and the Father had, since before he came, known that he would come to do and defeat enemies that we could not defeat, so that his joy may be in us. I forget the number right now. Who for the joy set before him endured the cross. I think it's in Hebrews. so that his joy may be in us and that our joy might be complete. So my last comments here in this fourth point is about the one command Jesus has in this picture, in this topic about abiding. Because I think sometimes you're not going to know how to do it. You're going to stumble. You're going to struggle. You're going to wrestle. And we're going to do that together. But there is one command that I'd like us to read out loud together. Would you just look at verse 12? I'll wait for a second so we can get it up on the screen. And we're just going to read together the one command that Jesus gives to us. When all else fails, when you're not sure what to do, Jesus says, verse 12, ready? Go. My command is this, love each other as I have loved you. I know my hearing isn't that bad. You weren't reading. You'll have another chance in a minute. Love is the currency. Not sure how to act, not sure what to do, not sure how to be Christian in this culture, in today's climate, in this age. Well, I'm going to read this again. Verse 12, your second chance, your redo. Ready, go. My How did he love us? Self-sacrificially, to the point of death, humiliation, torture. It's a cross-shaped mission that we have. We love each other. We are called to love each other as Christ loved us, because it's an upside-down kingdom, and so much of this life that we've chosen to connect ourselves to, this vine that we want to have our branches be gaining their life from, is counterintuitive. But this is what makes us Christian. When we love like Jesus, this is what makes us Christian. It's not the word Christian. You can slap Christian on anything. Christian institution, Christian school, Christian anything. Can non-animate beings be Christian? No, only we can be Christian. And just like things aren't Christian because you say they're Christian, we are not Christian just because we say we're Christian. We must be Christian. We must act Christian. And loving each other as Jesus has loved us is where it starts. So there's something different about abiding. There's something different about those who abide in Christ. They think different, they act different, and they change and they grow. They think differently and act differently than they used to act, because to be an organic living branch is to go into places that you hadn't been before. You can't watch a branch on a vine grow and see it stay in the same place. This is the picture that Christ is giving for us. We've got to move beyond, yeah, I asked Jesus into my heart, but all I really care about now is my education or my salary or the lifestyle I want to live or my 401k or my retirement fund. These things start to sound like Isaiah 5. Ed house to house, join field to field, buy another rental property, consider investing in an Airbnb so I can take better vacations. And justice and righteousness cannot be found in the vineyard of the Lord. I think God cares a lot more about the homeless problem in Atlanta or needy refugees in Clarkston than he does about how comfortable I might be in my retirement. Would you agree with that? Which one do you think I spend more time thinking about? I'm not my wife. My wife has a tremendous heart of compassion and actually self-sacrifices her body, her energy, her time, her family's needs sometimes, to go do ministry in Clarkston. I don't. But I need to be moving towards that, not the other way around. What occupies your imagination? What does it mean that you are abiding in Christ? Are all your purposes and plans and hopes tied up with this? It's a very, very, very short-lived, temporary place to put our imaginations. And it doesn't lead to righteousness and justice. Maybe you don't know what to do. You can start with verse 12. How about one more time? Even better than your second time. Jesus has one command, and what is it? We can always start there. We can always start there. And so I concluded my four thoughts on what I thought was important to notice in this passage. And there were some leftovers. There were like some questions that I'm like, I never really answered that. Someone's going to ask me, well, what about this? And so I thought I'll just throw it into the sermon. And these are the four questions that I want to pose that we should also sort of notice that are there. And I'm not going to promise I have any better answer than I don't know to some of them. So, A, how many times is Jesus going to say, ask anything you wish, and it's yours? Because it came up in John 14. It came up today in verse 7. If you remain in me and my words remain in you, ask whatever you wish and it will be done for you. It's going to come up again in chapter 15 in verse 16, and it'll come up a fourth time. There's the answer to the question. In chapter 16. So I am not going to deal with it today. I didn't deal with it last time. I won't deal with it today. I won't deal with it when I do chapter 16 or 15, 16. I will probably, don't hold me to it, deal with it when we get to chapter 16. But part of the reason I'm not wanting to deal with it yet is I really don't know. I really don't know what Jesus is saying to me when he says, I can ask anything I want and get it. Because something's off about people we know that live like that or preach like that. And perhaps there's painful stories in our own stories about white-knuckling enough faith to believe that about something that didn't happen. So that's a really big question for me from this passage. And I hope by the time we get to chapter 16, the Lord has given me some good thoughts to share with you. But I'm wrestling on that one. B, who are these non-abiders, these non-fruit bearers? Who are these people? On the one hand, isn't it obvious? We think we know, right? It's not us. It's those other people being cut off and thrown into the fire. Duh. Yeah, I know, but it's such a common trope in the New Testament that people who say, duh, I know what God thinks and I know what the right answers are, being highlighted for me as the people that most need to examine themselves and pay attention and reread their Bibles, that I'm leery of ever having that kind of an attitude. And I would recommend you as well exercise humility versus pride at all times. So the other hand is this. I'm asking questions like, well, what happens when I don't bear the right fruit? Or an easier question, what happens when he doesn't bear the right fruit? You know, because it's obvious he's not bearing much fruit. What are the consequences of that? When do you get cut off and burned? Verse 8 says, much fruit is how I show myself to be a disciple. Can I be a disciple with not so much fruit? Where's the cutoff? Does not enough evidence mean not a disciple? I'm not sure exactly what this means. which makes me want to pursue it, which makes me want to bear fruit, which I think is a good thing. But what really stumps me is what Jesus says in verse 2. I do not understand why he refers to cut off branches as being in Christ. That seems to be the opposite of what I thought was being pictured in this whole passage. It's a strange way to phrase it. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit. Is he talking about Israel again? Is it just a matter of the parable of the wheat and the tares? And there's just a lot of things that Dan Johnson is never going to know. And leave it alone. Leave the field alone and let God take care of it at the end. I don't know. Which leads me to see what exactly is pruning. If I'm picturing a gardener, and I'm a suburban boy through and through growing up, don't have a lot of farming experience, but I have a general idea of what pruning must look like. Does it look much different than like cutting off? What is pruning a branch versus cutting off a branch? Does it look totally different? Can we tell when God is pruning other people? Can we tell when God is cutting off other people? I'm not sure these are questions I should be answering. But I wonder what pruning is. What does pruning look like in my life? And again, Jesus shocks me in verse 3. He says to the disciples, "You are already clean because of the word I have spoken to you." Do you realize that that word clean is the same Greek word as prune? In other words, branches that bear fruit, I'll prune. You are already pruned back because of the fruit they bore? No, because of the word Jesus spoke. So something about being pruned has everything to do with what God has already done for me, and at the same time seems to have everything to do with me continuing to bear fruit and continuing to be pruned. I don't think the disciples here, even though they're declared to be already clean, are being told to, so don't pay attention to the rest of these sentences I'm saying to you. He's very much telling them they must bear fruit. That's their purpose. Could they mess it up? Could they not do enough, not bear enough, not love enough, not follow the one command of loving each other? My notes just say, see question D. Question D. How does one exactly abide? How does one remain in Christ? Is it like a never-ending quiet time? Do you think that's the answer? If that was the answer, the book of Acts would be like a story of a monastic movement. Everybody would have gone off into the wilderness and just hummed and prayed. It isn't that. That isn't the answer of what it means to abide. But it's not like an answer I feel like I can simply easily give you either of what does it mean to abide in Christ. So I suggest let's follow the logic of verses 9 through 12. A little earlier, I kind of corresponded every verse in 9 through 12 to love. Now I'm going to just sort of make my concluding four statements by connecting verses 9 through 12 with the word abiding. And again, try and get us in the right direction of, are we abiding? Am I abiding? Is there more abiding I need to experience in my life? I'm going to say we know this much from verses 9, 10, 11, and 12. Verse 9, the Godhead relationship originates our abiding. Remember that. Verse 10, obeying keeps us abiding. Remember that. Verse 11, joy authenticates our abiding. Remember that. And verse 12, self-sacrificing love proves our abiding. Those aren't on the screen, so I will read those again. The Godhead relationship originates our abiding. Obeying keeps our abiding, keeps us abiding. Joy authenticates our abiding. and self-sacrificing love proves our abiding. It's all intertwined. It's not at all simplistic or easy, and yet it's simple. Remain in me, Jesus says, and I will remain in you. It's initiated by God. You're already clean because of the word I have spoken to you, yet somehow it continues to demand everything of you. All I can say in closing, and the worship team may come if they are, is don't let up. Don't let up on your abiding and remaining in Christ. And never stop increasing your efforts to love each other. Don't let up and never stop increasing your efforts to love each other. And may we together learn to abide, that we may bear fruit. In Jesus' name.
Let's proclaim our love for the Lord as He has loved us first.
We love you, we'll never stop, can't live without you, Jesus.
He loves us so dearly that He brought His Son to die on the cross for us. When we love God, when we obey, when we abide in Him, everything changes.
When you walk into the room, everything changes. Darkness starts to tremble at the light that you bring. When you walk into the room, every heart starts burning, and nothing matters more than just to sit here at your feet and worship you.
Sing that one more time. When you walk, God, when you walk.
When you walk into the light. Starts to vanish.
Jesus said, "If you keep my commands, you will remain in my love." That's all I have to say about that. You're dismissed.